Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Elements of Investing, Easy Lessons for Every Investor, Updated Edition, by Burton G. Malkiel and Charles D. Ellis, narrated by Keith Sellon-Wright. Limit of Liability, Disclaimer of Warranty. While the publisher and author have used their best efforts in preparing this book, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this book, and specifically disclaim any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives or written sales materials. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a professional where appropriate. Neither the publisher nor author shall be liable for any loss of profit or any other commercial damages, including but not limited to special, incidental, consequential, or other damages. Preface to Updated Edition. At her death in 1999, at the age of 91, Osceola McCarty bequeathed $150,000 to the University of Southern Mississippi. For her generosity, she received an honorary degree from the university and the Presidential Citizens Medal, the second highest civilian award in the United States. Her gift was all the more extraordinary because she earned her living washing clothes. At a very young age, Ms. McCarty was taught by her mother to be a great saver. She made trade-offs, spending what she needed to live on, but foregoing any luxuries. She had a used TV, but only watched shows that she could pick up over the airwaves. She did not own a car, electing to walk everywhere. She lived in a house that she inherited from her uncle. Over the course of her lifetime, she amassed a remarkable nest egg, estimated to be about $250,000. Ms. McCarty was the very model of a disciplined saver. Her example shows that a little bit of willpower and, yes, thrift can add up to big things. This is lesson number one in any sound financial plan, and it is lesson number one in this wonderful book by Burton G. Malkiel and Charles D. Ellis. Over the past several decades, Malkiel's Random Walk Down Wall Street and Ellis's Winning the Loser's Game have helped millions of people to understand the fundamentals of investing and to reach their financial goals. In Elements of Investing, Malkiel and Ellis distill their wisdom and experience into a sensible plan for people to save and invest. Some money managers warn that successful investing can be carried out only by the most sophisticated and talented professionals. And, of course, these managers claim to be members of that small club. Malkiel and Ellis argue that successful investing should not be the province of a select few. Football games are not always won by the best quarterback. They are won in the trenches. Investors have to win the war of blocking and tackling. Elements of Investing provides a roadmap that can multiply your savings to reach your financial target. It starts with understanding the answers to some basic questions, like, when will you need this money? And how well can you tolerate investment risk? The answers to those questions can help you build an appropriate asset allocation between stocks, bonds, and cash. It should be a balanced approach, and the investments should be broadly diversified. Most importantly, the authors stress that the investments must be low cost. One certainty about investing is that for a given return, the more you spend to earn it, the less of it you will keep. The authors conclude that the best way to implement your plan is to invest in low-cost index funds. This approach is certainly not sexy. Blocking and tackling is not sexy. But I dare say that most investors would be better off if they followed this strategy. Indeed, it's the kind of approach that we espouse at Vanguard. It has served many clients very well over the years. This updated edition of Elements of Investing brings a clear-eyed perspective to the current environment, including a new chapter describing the aftermath of the global financial crisis and its impact on the way people are rethinking their approach to investing. Pundits bombard us with claims that the old rules no longer apply, They say that we are in a protracted environment of low returns and high volatility, and that people should abandon buy-and-hold investing and become more opportunistic. Malkiel and Ellis take umbrage with these claims, and at Vanguard, so do we. The authors reaffirm the views they expressed in the first edition, and they provide supporting evidence. Diversification, rebalancing, dollar-cost averaging, and low-cost indexing remain the best path to achieve investment success. This book is a must-read for all investors, those new to investing and those who have been at it for a while. It should be required reading in high school because the power of compounding is particularly valuable at a young age. But veteran investors will also benefit from reading this book, as it debunks many misconceptions and identifies behavioral biases that stand in the way of successful investing. And just to make sure you do not fall prey to the siren song of a better way, you should reread this book every several years. Over the course of my career, I've seen time and again how the simple principles discussed in this book have helped ordinary people achieve extraordinary results. George U. Gus Sauter, Chief Investment Officer, Vanguard, October 2012. Foreword. In The Elements of Investing, Charlie Ellis and Burt Malkiel, two of the investment world's greatest thinkers, combine their talents to produce a remarkable guide to personal finance. Having already written two of the finest books on financial markets, Ellis's Winning the Loser's Game and Malkiel's A Random Walk Down Wall Street, why should the authors revisit the subject of their already classic volumes? The sad fact is that in the cacophony of advice for individual investors, few sane voices are raised. In writing The Elements of Investing, the authors provide an important service to the lay reader, honing their message to the bare essentials by heeding Albert Einstein's dictum that everything should be made as simple as possible, but not simpler. Investors have three tools to deploy in the portfolio management process: asset allocation, market timing, and security selection. Asset allocation involves setting long-term targets for each of the asset classes in which an investor invests. Market timing consists of short-term bets against the long-term asset allocation targets. Security selection deals with the construction of the asset classes that an investor chooses to employ. Ellis and Malkiel correctly focus on asset allocation, since asset allocation accounts for more than 100% of investor returns. How can it be that more than 100% of returns come from the asset allocation decision? Market timing and security selection involve significant costs in the form of management fees paid to outside advisors and commissions extracted by Wall Street brokers. Such costs ensure that investors will underperform by the totality of investment management costs, which represent transfers from investors to their agents. Hence, the expensive activities of market timing and security selection reduce the returns available for the community of investors, and that is the reason asset allocation explains more than 100% of investor returns. Ellis and Malkiel observe that investors consistently make perverse market timing decisions, chasing hot performers and dumping laggards. Study after study of mutual fund trading concludes that investors buy high and sell low, subtracting value with their timing decisions. Ellis and Malkiel sensibly advise investors to adopt a coherent long-term strategy and stick with it. Security selection decisions further reduce returns. Ellis and Malkiel cite depressing statistics regarding the failure of the majority of mutual fund managers to exceed the returns of low-cost, passive, market-matching index strategies. The documented dismal numbers only begin to capture the enormity of the situation. Ellis and Malkiel cite numbers only for funds that survived, a relatively successful subset of the mutual fund universe. The failures, which as a group produced miserable returns, are nowhere to be measured. Many funds disappeared. The Center for Research in Security Prices collects data on all mutual funds, dead or alive. As of December 2008, The center tracked 39,000 funds, only 26,000 of which are active. The 13,000 failed funds do not show up in the author's studies of past returns because the failed funds do not have current track records. They disappeared, after all. Considering the experience of mutual funds, dead and alive, reinforces Ellis and Malkiel's advice to take the low-cost, passive approach. Of course, even in a slim volume, quibbles arise. I view home ownership more as a consumption good and less as an investment asset. I cast a skeptical eye on Ellis and Malkiel's implicit endorsement of stock picking in their confessions regarding personal success in security selection. Is it surprising that two of the greatest figures in modern finance would figure out how to beat the market? Yes, they can pick stocks. The rest of us cannot. I more emphatically recommend Vanguard, which, along with TIAA CREF, operates on a not-for-profit basis and thereby eliminates the money management industry's pervasive conflict between profit motive and fiduciary responsibility. Quibbles aside, the elements of investing delivers an important and fundamentally valuable message. When I was a doctoral student at Yale in the late 1970s, my dissertation advisor, Nobel laureate James Tobin, suggested that I read A Random Walk Down Wall Street to learn about how markets really work. Burt Malkiel's wonderful book provided a critical foundation for my academic work. When I returned to Yale in the mid-1980s to manage Yale's endowment, I came across Investment Policy, the predecessor to Winning the Loser's Game. Charlie Ellis's marvelous volume informed my approach to investment management in countless ways. Now, Charlie Ellis and Burt Malkiel have produced a magnificent primer on investing for all of us. Follow their recommendations and prosper. David F. Swensen, author of Unconventional Success, A Fundamental Approach to Personal Investment, Chief Investment Officer, Yale University, July 2009. Introduction. In 104 years of study and experience, 54 for Bird and 50 for Charlie, here are the elements of investing we wish we'd always known. Experience may well be the best teacher, but the tuition is very high. Our objective is to provide individual investors, including our delightful grandchildren, the basic principles for a lifetime of financial success in saving and investing, all in a book of straight talk that can be heard in just a few hours. There are many good books about investing. Indeed, we've even written a few ourselves. But most investing books run to 400 pages or more and go into complex details that tend to overwhelm normal people. If you're like most people, you have neither the patience nor the interest to plow through that much detail. You want to get the main things right. Still, having unbiased information about financial decision-making and avoiding costly investing errors is critically important. That's why we present the most important lessons in this easy-to-read, jargon-free little book. If you happen to be familiar with William Strunk Jr. and E.B. White's classic book, The Elements of Style, you will recognize one of the original sources of inspiration for this book, and why we are so brief. If you are unfamiliar with Strunk and White, don't worry. All you need to know is that they whittled down the art of powerful writing to a few basic rules of usage and composition. In less than 92 pages, they shared everything about writing that truly mattered. Brevity and precision became instant virtues. Strunk and White's wafer-thin classic has chugged along for decades. No doubt, it will outlive us all. We now dare state our goal on the equally important topic of investing. How surprising to us that everything of importance on such a heady topic can be reduced to rules you can count on one hand. Yes, investing can be that simple if your brain remains unclouded with taxing complexities. These rules will truly make a difference. Our promise? Reading this book will be the best time you could spend to put yourself on the right path to long-term financial security. Then, over your lifetime, you can pick this book up again to scan its lessons and remind yourself what is elemental if you want to turn a loser's game into one you can really win. It all starts with saving. This is a short, straight talk book about investing. Our goal is to enhance your financial security by helping you make better investment decisions and putting you on a path toward a lifetime of financial success and, particularly, a comfortable and secure retirement. Don't let anyone tell you that investing is too complex for regular people. We want to show you that everybody can make sound financial decisions. But it doesn't matter whether you make a return of 2%, 5%, or even 10% on your investments if you have nothing to invest. So it all starts with saving. 1. Save. Save. The amount of capital you start with is not nearly as important as organizing your life to save regularly and to start as early as possible. As the sign in one bank read, little by little you can safely stock up a small reserve here, but not until you start. The fast way to affluence is simple. Reduce your expenses well below your income, and shazam, you are affluent because your income exceeds your outgo. You have more than enough. It makes no difference whether you are a recent college graduate or a multimillionaire. We've all heard stories of the schoolteacher who lived modestly, enjoyed life, and left an estate worth over $1 million. Real affluence after a life of careful spending. And we know one important truth. She was a saver. But it can also go the other way. A man with an annual income of more than $10 million, true story, kept running out of money. So he kept going back to the trustees of his family's huge trusts for more. Why? Because he had such an expensive lifestyle, private plane, several large homes, frequent purchases of paintings, lavish entertaining, and on, and this man was miserably unhappy. In David Copperfield, Charles Dickens's character Wilkins Micawber pronounced a now famous law. Annual income, £20. Annual expenditure, £19, 19 and 6. Result, happiness. Annual income, £20. Annual expenditure, £20, aught and 6. Result, misery. Saving is good for us, for two reasons. One reason for saving is to prevent having serious regrets later on. As the poet John Greenleaf Whittier wrote, "Of all sad words of tongue and pen, the saddest are, it might have been." This line is from a poem entitled Maud Muller, written in 1856. "I should have, and I wish I had," are two more of history's saddest sentences. Another reason for saving is quite positive. Most of us enjoy the extra comfort and the feeling of accomplishment that comes with both the process of saving and with the results, having more freedom of choice, both now and in the future. No regrets in the future is important, or will be, to all of us. No regrets in the present is important, too. Being a sensible saver is good for you, but deprivation is not, so don't try to save too much. You're looking for ways to save that you can use over and over again by making these new ways your new good habits. Or, as Malcolm Gladwell suggests in Blink, you might try to get taller. Being 6 feet tall adds over $5,000 a year to your income because our society prefers taller people, so they enjoy better-paying careers. The real purpose of saving is to empower you to keep your priorities, not to make you sacrifice. Your goal in saving is not to squeeze orange juice from a turnip or to make you feel deprived. Not at all. Your goal is to enable you to feel better and better about your life and the way you are living it by making your own best-for-you choices. Savings can give you an opportunity to take advantage of attractive future opportunities that are important to you. Saving also puts you on the road to a secure retirement. Think of saving as a way to get you more of what you really want, need, and enjoy. Let saving be your helpful friend. First, do no harm. The first step in saving is to stop dissaving, spending more than you earn, especially by running up balances on your credit cards. There are few, if any, absolute rules in saving and investing, but here's ours. Never, never, never take on credit card debt. This rule comes as close as any to being an inviolable commandment. Scott Adams, the creator of the Dilbert comic strip, calls credit cards the crack cocaine of the financial world. They start out as a no-fee way to get instant gratification, but the next thing you know, you're freebasing shoes at Nordstrom. Credit card debt is great, but not for you or any other individual. Credit card debt is great for the lenders, and only the lenders. Credit cards are a wonderful convenience, but for every good thing, there are limits. The limit on credit cards is not your announced credit limit. The only sensible limit on credit card debt is zero. Credit card debt is seductive. It's all too easy to ease onto the slippery slope and slide down into overwhelming debts. You never, well, almost never, get asked to pay off your debt. The bank will graciously allow you to make low monthly payments. Easy. Far too easy. Your obligations continue to accumulate and accumulate until you get the letter.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.